Okay, good evening.
I'm Sikivu Hutchinson. I'm the writer and the director of White Nights, Black Paradise. Welcome. The Black lesbian poet and activist Audre Lorde once said, if I didn't define myself for myself, I would be crunched into other people's fantasies for me and eaten alive. And Lorde was one of the most fiercely eloquent champions of the revolutionary right of Black women to witness and speak their truths as a form of political resistance. And certainly her words resonate deeply when we consider the impact of the November 1978 Jonestown, Guyana massacre on African-American collective memory and mourning. The majority of the over 900 People's Temple Church members who died in Jonestown were African-American women, men, and children. 48% were African-American women. They were educators, they were organizers, they were counselors, they were writers, they were artists, letter carriers, veterans, blue collar workers, white collar workers, extended family members from California, Texas, Alabama, and Mississippi. They were seniors, they were youth, they were religious folks, they were skeptics, they were atheists, they were queer, they were straight, they were cisgender. They were Black women who lived, loved, and struggled with the hypocrisy of the American dream, only to be re-victimized in death by the scorn, indictment, and anti-Black misogyny of the white gaze and white supremacy. Their belief in the revolutionary promise of People's Temple was a testament to their long legacy of activism and organizing in the face of erasure. And so in an effort to counter the marginalization of Black women in these spaces, I've tried to bring Black voices to the page, stage, and screen through adaptations of my 2015 novel, White Nights, Black Paradise. As a piece of speculative fiction, it is interested in troubling the boundaries between fact and fiction in order to expose how myths about Jonestown were constructed over time through multiple interpretations, voices, and memories. The play is the first dramatic literary production to focus on the lived experiences, social history, moral dilemmas, and relationships of Black women in the People's Temple community. And I've been extremely fortunate to work with a cast of phenomenal multi-generational actors from LA and San Francisco, some of whom performed in the production's LA debut at Hudson Theater in 2018. The play contextualizes People's Temple vis-a-vis the Great Migration, the women's movement, Black power, and Black disillusionment with traditional African-American church institutions. It also problematizes historical portrayals of Jonestown that center on Jim Jones while marginalizing Black women's self-determination. A key element also evokes the diversity of religious belief among the members of People's Temple, who ran the gamut from Christian Pentecostal to atheist. In researching the rich history of People's Temple in Jonestown, I am deeply indebted to Black women survivors I had an opportunity to interview and collaborate with, specifically Leslie Wagner Wilson, the author of the memoir, Slavery of Faith, SFPD Captain Yolanda Williams, Jordan Vilches, Juanel Smart, and Janet Schuler. Their stories and brave activism have been foundational for this work, in addition to the powerful archival material collected by alternative considerations of Jonestown curators, Rebecca Moore and Fielding McGee. Throughout the adaptation process, I've been acutely aware of the ways in which Black experiences in Jonestown are often appropriated for mainstream consumption, taken out of context, and depoliticized. And this is especially true in this still Trumpian pandemic era in which Black folk continue to struggle with the legacies of slavery, Jim Crow, and racialized sexual violence, as well as state violence, within which the prevailing narrative of hoodwinked Black women without agency has become an insidious cliche. As San Francisco pastor and activist Hannibal Williams, a member of the Western Addition community organization, noted, the time was right to produce a man like Jim Jones. The circumstances of the community that is broken up, in which the San Francisco Redevelopment Agency literally destroyed the neighborhood of Fillmore, and the process made the neighborhood ripe for any kind of solution. Ultimately, quote, the temple's social and political projects and stances need to be read against the background of calls issued by Black communities in San Francisco and elsewhere for an activist response by Black churches and religious institutions to the material struggles of African Americans, especially in the face of housing dispossession, unemployment, and mass incarceration. And so these and other factors inform why People's Temple and Jonestown remain relevant to contemporary discussions about reparations in the US. How else could a supporter speaking in glowing terms about Jonestown in September 1977, approximately a year before the massacre, make this pointed statement? She said, "I would like to say to my friend, Jim Jones, and all my sisters and brothers from People's Temple who are in Guyana, that there are people here, not only in the San Francisco Bay Area, but also across the country who are supporting you, who are with you. We know that you have participated and brought people to all the marches and demonstrations, specifically to free Ben Chavis and the Wilmington 10. And there were civil rights activists who were wrongfully convicted of arson in the early 70s. And thousands of petitions have been sent to government officials, circulated and signed by members of People's Temple. And so we are very deeply obligated to you for what you have done to further the fight for justice in the struggle against oppression and racism." That supporter was Angela Davis. And now we bring you excerpts from White Nights Black Paradise. We're very appreciative to the AAACC for allowing us this platform. And these excerpts primarily focus on People's Temple and the climate before immigration to Jonestown. Thank you.
White Nights Black Paradise by Sikivu Hutchinson. Setting. The action of the play occurs in the local community of Fillmore in San Francisco, in Indianapolis, Indiana, and Jonestown, Guyana. Time shifts back and forth non-chronologically from the late 1950s during the civil rights movement into the late 1970s. Act 1, Scene 1. The sound of banging. Night watch woman in a guard's uniform bangs on a TV with a rabbit ear antenna. A clipboard and a stack of newspapers are beside her on a small desk.
Dover Air Force Base, 1978. Sub-zero weather has kicked in the teeth of Delaware.
The night watch woman bangs on the TV again. She sits down in front of the TV. A voice starts talking statically in interview mode.
Well, it's the largest military morgue in the nation. Yes, they're still shipping them in. Yes, we aim to make sure they're all accounted for, tagged, properly labeled. Yes, the next of kin of crack forensics team, slave round the clock in the jungle, Guyana roaches the size of flying saucers. Nothing that a stiff black thing of coffee can't cure. Well, you boys know I can't whistle Silent Night in this here cold. But I can do Dixie.
A black woman sits in a chair in a semicircle holding a doll swaddled in a blanket like a baby. One by one, the women from the company join her and take a seat. The women hold up church fans in front of their faces. They lower them and begin to speak.
Oh, I don't know. Must have been some crazy misguided niggas from Bama deep in the backwoods.
Just up and went boop. In the middle of the night.
Traveling 4,000 God per second miles in coach class? Shit.
Ain't no accounting for California fruitiness.
Ain't no account for Southern fried Negro mule-headedness.
Hey, you'd be fruity, royally fruity, too, after 40 fucking years of scraping the caramelized shit off Miss Anne's linoleum.
Blaspheming motherfuckers.
Yeah, well, a little blaspheming is good for the soul and the digestive system every now and then.
Cross my heart and hope to...
Honestly, best beloved, what would you miss?
Shuffling off this here mortar coil.
Spiderweb dew on the grass. French toast with melted butter and warm syrup. The split-second post-orgasm toes uncurling like... Al Green and Perry Como's mutant baby singing the Bee Jesus out of a heretofore crappy human night. Their liquid eyes watching. San Francisco, 1975.
Jerry, what say you?
The sound of a newscast echoes from the watchwoman's TV.
Good evening. We interrupt this program to bring you a special bulletin from KTVT.
They came out with pitchforks when we moved here. The women in their white pearls and pressed gloves. The men dressed to the nines in suits and ties, beat down on a steaming pulp after a long day at the office, wraiths fastening their lips to big orange bull horns like it was the bottom of the ninth. At a Giants game, the whitest of the whitest stalking the joint out in the streets for a tea party, pinkies raised at attention.
We could see the bay curling out at us when we drove in from Cottonwood, California. The five of us packed into the Dodge, watching green-eyed monster waves cut in pieces by the bridge, shimmering, debating, telling us how the cause was going to cure everything.
A mob scene downtown as demonstrators packed a city council meeting this afternoon in protest of the condemnation of hundreds of apartment units.
I watched the wrecking ball knock down our place like it wasn't nothing but a house of popsicle sticks. Boom! Then there was a hunk of sky. Where Daddy's card table had been. Boom! Right where he slapped bones and played poker on the weekends with his friends. Boom, boom! Right where Mommy's people had a high old time making fun of his wannabe Mexican nigger Spanish.
Boom!
A white secretary is seated typing. The secretary rips the paper from the typewriter and balls it up. She makes like she's going to throw it at a trash can, then hesitates.
Well, thank you, Mr. Newscaster. Hope the council president got his mealy mouth fence sitting little ass kicked. Oh, give me a home where the buffalo roam. Jesus, those people are still carrying on down there.
Terrence Strayer walks onto the stage carrying a briefcase.
Please thank Mr. Malloy again for giving me the opportunity to interview with the firm.
Absolutely, sweetie. We had over 100 applications for the junior accountant position. We handle some of the biggest firms and community organizations in the Bay. You come work for us, we let you tool around in your training wheels for a few days, then it's showtime.
Okay. Well, when can I expect to hear back?
We'll call you, hon.
Carl Harper, lead temple organizer, comes on stage. Taryn takes out a dollar from her briefcase and goes to the white secretary's desk. Carol stands over the white secretary's desk holding a package. The secretary gives her a clipboard and takes the package.
Hello.
Hi, hon. How's the Vanguard today?
Traffic out of here is going to be brutal, and the report says the Nimitz is jammed. Reverend Jim is doing his radio show live on the election in an hour and needs to be in the station to work the phones.
Can't say I've ever heard the pleasure, had the pleasure of ever hearing the Reverend live in the flesh. We don't get the fancy invites like the politicians get, being lowly accountants.
Fancy invites, please. All are welcome in our house, 24/7, 365. You should come someday.
Separation of church and state. They want to keep it that way. Happy as clams winding through the lovely thickets of 74 tax returns. Give the good Reverend our regards. I hear he's got a lot on his plate with the new homes and apartment buildings, getting to be a regular city treasure.
National treasure. We've got churches coast to coast.
Yes, quite the entrepreneurs, good head for business, and all those fragile souls quivering in
Do you mind making change for the bus?
The white secretary opens the drawer and givers change. Taryn exits. Carol nods goodbye, then follows Taryn out to the street.
You know, I think you'll be running the place in a few years.
Excuse me?
Sorry. I didn't mean to be forward. I don't think, though, I've ever seen an Afro-American there, except maybe a temp tucked away in the break room.
That so?
The place is downright antediluvian. Malloy's got one showpiece black on his board that he trots out for galas, and all us ladies get ghettoized in the secretarial pool. Integrating places like this is something we're really invested in.
We?
Carol digs into her bag, takes out a pamphlet, and hands it to Taryn.
Our church. We do freedom circles about social and political issues and have cultural events every weekend.
The Rainbow Family?
Those are Reverend Jim's children. Orphans he's adopted. Oldest son's black, near genius. And Jim and his wife got him at birth in Indiana.
My sister and I just moved from here from there.
You have kids? By the way, I'm Carol.
You all have some kind of pull with Malloy and his people?
Pull?
Yeah, clout, influence. Meaning instead of hoping I get to be the first in the flesh Afro-American hired, you can actually do something about it?
Well, I don't know that we...
Let's have your God move on that one then.
We're not based on God.
A white elephant church that's not based on God? Okay, good thing, but how'd you manage that?
Taryn's younger sister, Hi, enters the building.
You almost done here? I'm late for my appointment.
Thanks for the literature.
What was that all about?
White woman hawking peace and love belongs to some kind of church represented by Malloy's firm.
She hands Hi the pamphlet.
Got a whole lot of color up in here. Cute kids.
Pastor's some kind of urban missionary. How do you feel?
Like shit.
You take the pain pills?
For the 100th time, yes. How'd the interview go?
Okay. Evidently, they're hiding their Negroes in the break room.
I applied at the laundromat and the AMP today. When I get my first check, I'm paying you back for the medical bills and everything.
Most important thing now is you bouncing back mentally.
I'm already bounced back.
You sure?
It was an abortion, not a lobotomy.
Well, it was the best fucking thing that could have happened to you right now. We don't need another no daddy mouth to feed when we just landed here and barely making it.
Carla got one 2 years ago from a $50 butcher. Fucking bled the whole car ride home.
What's that stuff on your hands?
Oh, phone numbers. Must have called 50 different help wanted places while you were up in there. And no dice. Can't do that Doris Day decoy voice like you do.
Stop marking up your hands. Want people to think you're an undisciplined psycho?
Matter of fact, yeah. You and Mama and the rest of the world already do. No job, shady prospects, 2 abortions in 2 years, a real model citizen.
Rent's due in a week.
Right. Another reminder that I'm a deadbeat.
Heard the landlord on the building next door might jack the rent up, which probably means we're next.
Look, if one of these gigs come through, I'll be able to give you something soon.
Look, it's okay. I can float us for a bit.
Right. Like you always do.
If I get this job, the first check will be in 2 weeks. After rent, we'll have enough to pay for the light bill, food, bus fare, dry cleaning, because I'm gonna have to wear a suit every day. Shit, then there's the interest on the abortion bill if it goes to collection. You want me to ask Mama for some-
Told you, no, there's no need. Sure as hell don't wanna hear her mouth about cleaning up the aftermath of me getting so-called knocked up whoring around. Itching to do an exorcism because we fucked. I loved every minute of it, and I ain't sorry. There has to be some Black-owned businesses around here that are hiring or that I can apprentice with.
You'll have to get in line with the hundreds of others looking. Maybe if you went back to school.
Managing me.
It's shit jobs with no degree, Hi. You can't slum like the sorority Barbie dolls in the secretarial pool.
Slumming? Look, I'm out here on the streets every damn morning trying to squeeze blood from a stone out of this high-ass place. Malcolm X said his alma mater was books, not no ivory tower.
Oh, very eloquent. He had a penis between his legs.
And what I wouldn't have given for it, for a day or so, to know what it's like to not be hunted and pawed down by men.
Or just to be bodiless.
Huh. Yeah, that's the ticket, sis. My 100th brilliant plan in life. To invent a machine that would let little girls go poof on demand. Mama would be right proud for a minute.
Reading from the temples, the People's Temple pamphlet.
Mm. Hot meals served 6 nights a week. You think they got those white girls burning greens and cornbread after the service?
The lights go up on the interior of a church with rows of chairs facing an altar and a podium. Ida Lassiter, a journalist in her late 50s, sits in the back watching the crowd as members of all races and ages flow through the aisles. On the stage, an organist, a drummer, and several other musicians watch the crowd file in.
Quick, can you catalog your favorite smells in the whole wide world in 10 seconds? I was always partial to lilacs. Sickly, overbearingly sweet, yes, but they were my grandmother's favorite. The tiny little refuse that she could savor before being told, quit, tar, baby, this ain't you. Word had it that the town fathers, the mayor, the sheriff, the tax assessor, asked Wilbur, stripes busting from his chest, just back from Iwo Jima, quick, nigga, catalog your favorite smells in 10 seconds. Just before they pulled him off the train and gutted him from ear to ear for refusing to take off his uniform. Rot gut winner of 44. This was my first case.
The spotlight goes off her as Maybelline Jones, a white woman in her late 50s, walks through the crowd with a tambourine. She pauses to greet nearly every parishioner, hugging, patting shoulders, smiling warmly at children. She makes her way to the back of the church, stopping at Ida's seat.
Hello, Mrs. Lassiter. Nice of you to come this evening.
Evening. Looks like another good turnout.
Yes, we're quite blessed.
The San Francisco press has been flattering.
Somehow. To what do we owe this pleasure?
Working on a new piece.
I heard your paper was shut down.
The official reason was cost overruns. It was only a matter of time.
I'm sorry.
Don't be. Wasted pathos. There's far more deserving subjects.
Sister Leslie, a young church member, walks up to Maybelline holding a flower.
I just wanted to thank you for the care package you sent us, Mother May. My boy's recovering just fine from his operation.
Oh, don't mention it. We're hoping you and your family can move into one of the Temple Apartment Collectives soon.
Oh, we'd like that. The buzzards at the bus company say they can't give me health insurance because I'm working part-time. They'd cheat us out of breathing air if they could.
Check with Carol about getting your son into our new clinic.
She takes Leslie by the arm, turning for a moment back to Ida, smiling coolly as Ida takes a notepad from her purse and starts writing. Leslie joins the congregation.
At some point, I'd like to sit down with you, Mrs. Jones.
Oh, no, I don't think so. There's nothing I could tell you that you haven't already heard straight from Reverend Jones's mouth.
Come on now. You must be proud of him and all the progress the church has made since Indiana. And what's an empire without a good woman behind it?
Proud, yes, of course. This is no empire, though. Our family has...
Proud of him and yourself. Starting this place from nothing. Working your fingers to the bone. Venturing clear across the country and opening up housing collectives for poor folk against the backdrop of that elegant singing voice of yours. You still lead the choir?
When I can. I'm still called. Light of my life being raised a stodgy Episcopalian. But what with getting the new clinic up and running and coordinating our bus trips and helping folks get settled into the housing collectives, it's...
Exhausting.
Necessary. I've been ministering in my own way since I was a child, long before Jim or any man paid me any mind. I was a nurse in the state hospitals, saw the misery and suffering up close.
Black mothers turned away and babies with tuberculosis shoved into dirty wards. We only have a finite time on God's green earth, you know. And so you've surfaced at an opportune moment. Again.
Yes, yes. Surfaced. Watching from the walk. Your boys are traveling the world, I hear. Negroer, the black one, the white one, looking for new territory. Seems equal opportunity housing here in the Golden State still isn't enough.
You know, I know that this isn't news to you, Mrs. Lassiter, but there's a war here against poor people, against blacks, a deadly civil war, a cancer. Now, our family's fighting to stay together by the skin of our teeth, and all we ask is that members who have homes, who have property, join us in giving to those in greater need to root out the cancer.
Commentary. The next scene shifts to after the church service, where Hi, Taryn, and Jess, a therapist who provides counseling service for People's Temple, meet to discuss the church's background. The sisters encountered Jess earlier in the day. Scene 2 in the People's Temple Sanctuary. Hi and Taryn are seated in the church sanctuary preparing to leave. Hi picks up from a plate of food. Taryn searches through the bottom of her purse looking for change. Jess passes out flyers, sending off attendees warmly as they exit.
Night, sister. Good to see your face again. We're having a spiritual jubilee with the Nation of Islam next month here in the city and down in LA. Come check us out. Penny for your thoughts, ladies.
I should think they're worth more than that.
She continues rustling through her purse.
Bus fare.
For sure. I'm Jess. If you like, I could have one of the church vans take you home.
Okay. Taryn Strayer, this is my sister, Hi.
Ah, new to the city?
A few months. I just got a job at Malloy, Rifkin, and Burke. They do your church's books.
They treating you right over there?
It's a job.
I see you found the spread downstairs. Have time for a tour of the building?
Gotta get up early for a job interview.
Members continue flowing out of the church, fraternizing, buzzing about the sermon. A police siren sounds from outside.
Fuckers. Evening wouldn't be complete without them. They get a special thrill of out of rousing us from buildings black folks have owned for ages.
What else is new? They won't let us own nothing.
It's not about them letting us. We still have people left in Lyle Station, last black settlement in Indiana.
Yeah, a little rundown blip with an outhouse and a weather vane.
40 acres and a shithouse in the middle of nowhere. That's about Indiana speed.
One of the reasons why we got the hell out of there.
Oh yeah? The temple started there back in the 50s.
Deep in the heart of Plansville?
A lot of the old guard, Zippor, Deacon James are from back there.
Followed the church from ground zero then.
Out of the fat and into the frying pan.
How so?
Have you taken a look at this place? A close, hard look outside of the rarefied air of corporate accounting? The land of milk and honey is ladling up bullshit.
You always speak in bad metaphors?
Only to smart, mouthy women from Podunk, Indiana.
From Indianapolis. So I'll concede to 50% Podunk.
I grew up here, third generation. This whole area used to be mostly Japanese, except for us and a few white folk. Summers was a mini UN stickball summit in the streets until the feds started snatching their people up and throwing them in those concentration camps.
Devera Medeiros, a temple member and writer, walks up to them with a plate of food.
Girl, check out these red beans and rice and baked chicken Carol made. Skinny, no cooking ass is getting better with each lesson.
These two sisters just attended their first service tonight.
Right on. I'm DeVera.
She's one of the most talented writers in the Bay.
Baby, you too sweet. Gotta try this grub before it's gone. Ernestine done put her foot in some oxtails.
Keeping it meat free, sis. I'm transitioning from that artery clogging crap. Makes for clearer thinking.
I hear you. It was straight up macrobiotic gunk my last month of rehab. Cold fucking turkey, beaten to submission with brown rice and broccoli.
Rehab?
It was a temple program. A mix of spiritual and secular methodology. Treats addiction like a social psychological illness, not a crime. Unlike a lot of these state-run outfits. We view overcoming it as a process the whole community is responsible for.
I take it you were involved in the process then.
I'm a licensed psychotherapist.
In private practice?
One of the few Black woman-run practices in the state.
Our mother always ran to church, praying to God and Jesus every time trauma or tragedy hit.
Most of us think therapy is a white woman's luxury. Still is in many regards. So, you like that part of Jim's sermon, the critique of prayer?
I don't do organized religion. My sister dragged me here to the church, sniffed out a free meal with that bloodhound nose of hers. Plenty of times, I got my butt kicked when I was little for being the weird one, and the assholes who dogged me got the gold stars. That cured me of God, prayer, and magical thinking real quick.
Mm. And you?
No, I'm the agnostic fence sitter, or so she says. I happen to not give two shits as long as Mother Superior, the deacons, the prophets, and all them other crackpots don't put a straitjacket on me.
Carol walks in with two men, one white and one black, in business attire.
If it ain't Miss Anne and her minions.
That's the white girl who was handing out flyers at Taryn's office.
Carol Harper.
Coordinates operations.
Stays up under Reverend Jim like his second white shadow.
Oh, now I don't think Ms. Carol Ann is as compliant as all that. At least not behind closed doors.
Shit. Forget her. Who is that fine ass brother she's with?
Well, judging from the suits, they're probably some of Senator George Moscone's boys.
Oh, I heard he's favored to win over that right-wing zealot he's running against.
Yeah, we're canvassing for his mayoral campaign.
What promises has he made to Black folk?
The usual. Jobs, anti-poverty programs, an honorary seat at the police commission's table after the pigs crack heads in Fillmore.
And an end to Black folk getting kicked out of our homes.
Oh, he talks a good game. But you can't trust these shuck and jive politicians, white or black, to stick their necks out and buck the redeveloper parasites trying to gut our neighborhoods. Like I said, they fucked over the Japanese. Now it's our turn.
Yeah, but that's why we have to snag this guy. Otherwise, we'll just be niggas diving for table scraps.
If the city had its way, half of Middle America would be up in here. Hell, Carol's probably fucking the black one. Getting down and going down for the gauze. That's how those white motherfuckers did it during the Black Power days. Love to get them some black ghetto dick, then run home to daddy's money. That kind of politicking will keep her in Jim's good graces.
The Moscone boys shake Carol's hand and exit.
Welcome. I see you found our resident sages, DeVera and Jess. Taryn, right? Want me to get you all some sweet potato pie? It's divine.
Next time. I have work tomorrow.
Sure, of course. The firm hired you, I heard, to their credit. You planning on coming to the planning commission meeting tonight, Jess?
Like I always do.
Excellent. Appreciate your expertise, and you may have noticed that we had a visitor.
You mean Lassiter?
The inquiring mind and distinguished chronicler of Black life. Wants to cover us.
I'll find some people for her to talk to.
Thanks.
Carol exits.
Ida Lassiter, our own honorary race woman. It's important, you know, to support the Black press.
Except when they're propping up handkerchief head Negroes that don't say shit when they're taking our buildings.
Better than establishment white folks going down for the cause. Quite sure the black and white ones have their hands in the till. Or on ghetto dick. That the kind of language they taught you in therapy school?
A tad prudish, sis. It's called graduate school. Did my time for 3 years. And brothers have never been above throwing us under the bus for political leverage.
You got something against black men?
No, just the indoctrinated ones that act like white girls are the second coming.
And what percentage is that in your mind?
Seems like a big one in this city.
How are you qualified to comment? You've never been interested in being with anyone black.
Proves you don't know shit about me.
3 decades under the same roof, I think I have a pretty fair idea. Could write a fucking encyclopedia, illustrate it, copyright it, maybe even turn a profit one day if I don't score a steady job.
Maybe if you stop scapegoating your sister, be in line for some good karma.
Karma's for dumb shits. Can't eat it, fuck it, or take it to the bank. Later for this.
Speaking of the black press, good, bad, and different, I've got my own deadline to meet for the People's Forum. See y'all.
Bye, baby. Hope I didn't set off a riot between you two.
Nah, it's longstanding stuff. She's trying to get her bearings and it's just not happening fast enough.
Happens. New place, adjustments. There's things she can get involved with at the church to help smooth the transition. We do a women's rap group Thursdays. Why don't you bring her around?
Not my thing.
Okay. Can I get a private audience then?
Sure.
Jess gestures for Taryn to hold out her hand. She takes out a pen and writes her phone number on it.
Call me.
The two women exit. Hai is pacing at the bus stop outside the church. Ida walks up to her.
What I wouldn't give for a smoke.
Same here.
Nasty habit. Kicked it in 64 after I left Indianapolis. You wanted the temple flower too?
I'm a grown-ass unemployed black woman.
I like that. Join the club. We's the anointed.
Anointed. If this is anointed, I'd hate to see what hell looks like. They say God will find a way. Well, God ain't found me no way. Just like Reverend Jones says.
Broke as three church mice.
Yep. Brokety broke, broke, broke.
I'll smoke to that. Nobody will hire me in the newspaper business. I'm too old. Ornery and unfuckable. Three cardinal sins for a negress.
Oh, yeah. You're that race woman they were talking about.
In the dirty flesh. So you're quoting Jones.
You know how long I've been here without a lock on a decent paying job where I don't have to shake my broke black ass in a G-string for no benefits? 4 months while my sister soaks it up in corporate. Fuck yeah, I'm quoting Jones. What you got for me?
What you think you're owed?
All the promises you old guard Negroes made. Now you're all either dead or on the payroll.
I ain't dead or on nobody's payroll, baby girl.
Mm-hmm. Prove it. What's your black crystal ball say? What you gonna do for sisters who can't work, can't eat, can't feed the babies they got forced into popping out before they even knew what the fuck they wanted? I wanna travel the world. Go everywhere they say niggas ain't supposed to go. Rub their noses in it. Circumnavigate the globe in a goddamn silver rocket.
Lovely to have your head in the clouds. I did that once too.
Well, why'd you come here?
Big bad dreams.
Dreams or delusions?
Both.
You get your heart ripped out over all this too?
Need a smoke.
Inside a meeting hall, chairs are assembled in two rows. The women occupy the ones in the second row. Devera, High, and Foster are musicians and former temple members are seated in the front. Applause sounds and the Reverend Jim Jones' voice blares out from the loudspeaker.
Thank you, brothers and sisters. Peace. Peace.
A spiritual jubilee of sorts, best and brightest of the Afro-American religious establishment, suited, booted, and sniffing each other on a warm San Francisco night in the bicentennial.
We were on the road for 10 whole hours trying to get back here, and one of our buses broke down in Modesto. Pitch dark at night, not a soul around the grapevine, the most desolate stretch of highway in America when you got 100 tired, hungry children itching to climb out the window. We got out to look at the engine. The headlights swept over us like a dream. My son, Jimmy Jr., tries to flag down the car, and the darn thing speeds right on past. 10 minutes later, here comes another, Mrs. Seymour. Nice Hoosier white lady gets out to flag it down, and hell if that car didn't stop on a dime. And when the white man at the wheel sees a busload of black folk with Mrs. Seymour,
all ready to call the cavalry. Yeehaw!
Tomorrow we're laying a petition on city council. Stop the mass evictions. Can I get your signature, brother? Yeah, of course. Is new blood here endorsing it? Howdy, seen you somewhere before. You with the church band? Used to be on drums. You play?
Yeah, strictly thigh and tabletop handbone style.
Nice. I'm down for a duel later if you can hang.
Name the time and place. I've heard about you. You have a rep for being a braggart.
Who fed you that horse shit? DeVera? The voice of the lumpin' proletariat?
It's floating around. Not a bad thing to have on your resume if I was auditioning you.
We had you down to canvas the other night and you were MIA, brother. Right, and I'll continue to be MIA. Fighting for our political future ain't glamorous enough for you? Look, I got a job, a kid to feed, bills to pay. Ain't busting my ass for free no more. Ask Jim and Carol where the money they get from all this politicking is going. We know where it's going, brother. To keeping people housed, fed, clean, and awake. Yeah, awake like munchkins in a poppy field. You got a beef? Bring it up to the commission.
Jim on loudspeaker.
Set up slavery than apartheid. Got black folk hating themselves, squatting like dogs in their own country. Well, Southern fried apartheid is no different than what we got in San Francisco, where we're living on top of each other in first world slums.
Foster shakes his head and walks away.
Shit. Brother Foster is a flake, a rebel in his own mind. Could have played a leadership role and he showed his ass. You ever committed to anything in your life?
What kind of question is that?
Anything outside of yourself, your world. There's a war going on, you know. Nation of Islam, other churches, their people are joining us.
And no wonder. They keep black women bowing and scraping.
Three steps behind.
Mopping up shit.
While the anointed take credit for saving the race.
Nose in the air, Indiana Methodists bled my mother dry. With them sun up to sundown tithing marathons, rooking maids who still crapped in outhouses and barely had two pennies to rub together. I said I would never set foot in a so-called house of God again.
Same here. Priest looked straight at me and said, God forgives all freaks of nature conditionally. Motherfucker was tippling 100 proof between confessions and filling up anything baby-faced and breathing in the rectory coat room.
Now you're in the church, writing for the temple. Must feel strange. Believing fucked you up the first time. Now this is the only place you feel halfway right in. Go figure. We moved here from the grunge of brown fields, brown shotgun shacks, Negroes feeling us up on the bus and crackers propositioning us in the streets. And I was coming off this jackhammer abortion, just slam, 0 to 60, and with how crazy, beautiful, ugly, all rolled up into one this city is. It's a mirage, right? Drive closer and poof, goes up like the ghost of Dixie in the middle of the road. But the temple's gonna bust open the dirty shit, right? Right? With sisters pushing it, we got half a chance.
No one else is moving an agenda in this place, and we could use your energy.
I'll bet. Thanks for the vote of confidence. What's Jess's game?
Game?
All the strutting around, bad case of HNIC.
Ain't no game, it's battle mode. She's been strutting all her life to keep from going ape shit. Between the white boys on the licensing board trying to revoke her credentials, to flicking off the parasites that want to shut us down, you know how it is. Search and destroy. Hooking up with your sister is a good diversion.
She's nobody's diversion.
Joy, I meant joy, and just deserves a little.
Protective of her. That's sweet. And you?
This is my joy. And when I croak, I want my ashes sprinkled on the prime rib of every greasy fucking robber baron that snatched the bricks from our homes.
Just said something about a job at the new clinic y'all are opening.
Yeah, we got a waiting list for immunizations that's a mile deep. They need folks to do intake. Want me to put in a word for you? Be good to have you on board.
Thank you, Reverend Jones. Thank you for bearing witness this evening. And now we'll have a few words from Brother Tariq Muhammad of the Nation of Islam.
There's a temple meeting tomorrow night about stopping the evictions. You in?
The sound of cheering booms from the speakers. Devera stands and begins waving her hands in response.
Well, you in, sister?
Power concedes nothing without demand.
Yeah.
Scene 3, the home of Ernest Dean Markham, San Francisco, 1976. Ernest Dean Markham, a teacher and a temple member, is sitting on a couch with a cup of tea in her hand, grading papers. A table with a teapot is next to her and a number of family photos. Boxes and other personal effects are stacked up around the couch. A knocking sound is heard.
Come in, it's open.
She stands up at Ida Lassiter, comes in walking briskly. She is carrying a notebook and extends her free hand.
Hello, Mrs. Markham. Thank you for agreeing to meet with me. Such a lovely home. Moving soon?
In a few weeks, just got back from the temple's spiritual jubilee down in Los Angeles. Please, sit down. Tea?
I hear a lot of work went into that confab.
One of my students recited an excerpt from Dr. King's A Letter from a Birmingham Jail.
Fitting. Los Angeles is just day glow Jim Crow with dirty beaches and endless sunshine.
Beaches for the white folks. When we came out here from Tuscaloosa in the 50s, all those beaches were spook-free zones. LAPD would be all over us if we so much as dipped a toe in the parking lot or batted an eye at Blondie in her bikini.
Mm-hmm. Tuscaloosa, huh?
Came out in the winter of 55, few years before I had my son, Byron. I was too mouthy for the pinhead headmaster of the Negro girls' school I was teaching at back then.
And how did you land at the temple?
Some of the women in my former church had kids who were involved in the temple sports and music programs. Byron plays the trumpet, classically trained since he was 7.
Impressive.
And you, Mrs. Lassiter, how did you become involved? I know you've had a long association with the Reverend.
I started covering the church in the late 50s, organized a few sit-ins, boycotts with the Rev in good old Indiana Klan country. Back then, he put the B in bright-eyed and bushy-tailed.
I followed your work, all of it, back then. You have a fine record of journalism and distinguished service to the community.
Thank you.
Which makes it... Your little dalliance, that is, all the more curious.
That was a lifetime ago.
He was a married man.
How is that relevant to our conversation?
You were screwing a younger, married white boy with a family. I'm just trying to establish a chronology on your extracurricular involvement.
An impressionable young buck led astray by Jezebel.
If the dirty shoe fits.
Have you had any offers on the house?
A few. An agent from the church is handling it.
The church?
Proceeds from the sale will go to support our communal apartments and the new settlement we're building in South America.
The so-called Jonestown colony.
There's nothing so-called about it. We're building our own nation, Mrs. Lassiter. Ours. A nation of many races. A paradise within a black-ruled country.
That's madness! If you people keep deeding your homes to the temple, what will be left for your son, for the community, for the future of black people in this neighborhood?
A future, here. Do you have children, Mrs. Lassiter?
No.
Borrow some for a day. Or if that's too strenuous, drop in on a classroom of black children and get a good deep whiff of the poison they're spoon-fed by the white school moms who flee the ghetto in terror 2 seconds after the bell rings. Then talk to me about a future.
The women come on stage holding newspapers.
Newsflash! A black girl.
Negress in training.
Nay, negress.
Was kidnapped from the corner of Geary and Leavenworth, snatched up in broad daylight.
Bobby socks, bangs, library books, and all.
Oh, not Sally Sue with the gingham dress and the baby blues?
No.
Oh.
Operator, get me the police.
You know what it looks like, what it sounds like after a bomb has been dropped.
So quiet you can hear fleas. Fucking
empty buildings, empty bedrooms, hallways humming with steam heat, and the phantom pitter-patter of little feet tapping out Paradise Lost. Hail to the chief! What say you, negresses?
Guilty as charged.
Scene 4, Turenne and High's apartment. Turenne is just off work, in business attire holding a briefcase. She opens the door to let Jess in, Jess who sleeps in breathless and looking a little tired.
Some asshole tried to set the building on fire.
What?
Not the first time we've been threatened. Fortunately, the crisis has been averted. Carol got the cavalry out. You're a sight for sore eyes. They have you working overtime?
Goes with the turf.
Cry of the fly in the buttermilk.
What about you? Bet mine in the church is no cakewalk at the witching hour.
Difference is, we built it from the ground up.
And Jones?
He's just a vehicle, politically expedient. Hunkies can stick him on all the boards and blue ribbon panels in the city, but we're still gonna take what we need from up in here.
So y'all are driving. I thought Carol was.
She's got her ace in the hole with a kid she never sees, claims Jim's the daddy.
Well, why would she lie about that?
Why do white women do the things they do? I don't get in their business. Can I sit down? I'm beat.
High's still looking for a job.
Temple's opening a new clinic. I can hook her up.
Just like that?
If she's willing to work hard and not fuck around. Besides, I have a vested interest.
Maybe I should stick with hot tea tonight.
Oh, I don't think I'd have to get you drunk.
No, that won't be necessary. Ever had a hankering to be a preacher man? To look out over the masses and
grip a congregation with the palm of your sweaty hand?
Never. That sounds perverse.
Really? I mean, you say that Jones is just a vehicle. So what's the end game?
To blast out of this shithole.
You man in a lunar probe?
To 4,000 acres of our own in Guyana. Free and fucking clear. Got a plot to dedicate to my grandmother. Now that one, she was wicked with numbers, chemicals, dates. The resident apothecary and proud abortionist. Born and died a slave in Mississippi, zapped all the knockups free of charge after the overseers used the field women like human toilets. Maybe she didn't know Africa from the ooga booga shit about savages and jungle monkeys. But she knew I was coming someday. That and her own version of God was what likely kept her alive when all she could taste was death.
High's gone for the night.
Sure. I don't want to intrude. Besides, I've got to draft a letter for a writing party tomorrow. We're lobbying the state legislature to divest from South Africa.
Taryn takes out a bottle of wine and two glasses from the cupboard.
You can step off the soapbox for a few hours. Saw another building that was being bulldozed down the block. Nothing but a dark shell. I get off late and it's like a whole other city outside. It's ugly, manic, cutthroat.
Really? Maybe you just don't see it because you stay buttoned up in the office all day.
Buttoned up?
No offense meant. I know being stuck in the king's castle poring over dry stats is no picnic.
I love what I do.
Good. Because we need more sisters on the inside who can hold these fuckers accountable when the feds mess with our money.
You're probably aware that the church is looking to buy this building. Landlords want to jack up the rent by $50. And we're still waiting on them to get an exterminator out here.
That why I get the good wine tonight? For my connections? I'll take it up with the planning commission. Can't have a happy home with unwanted guests.
Speaking of which, who was that man hanging around in the sanctuary when we came through the other day?
Demaya? He's a good brother. Security. Monitors things.
Four.
What do you think? Insurance against what happened to all the other movements, organizations that got liquidated, taken down by informants and assassins, fuck-faced arsonists, Benedict Arnolds. Where the hell you been for the past 20 years, little Bo Peep? Any progress we've made has been derailed because some greedy Negroes were willing to go down on the cheap for the feds.
Bottom feeders.
That's right. Which one are you? Oh, shit. I got a little buzz. Or is this laced?
With truth serum.
What exactly have I been untruthful about?
Well, you've made a lot of promises.
She leans over and takes Jess's glass, drinks the dregs, and puts it on the table. She turns back to Jess, looking at her for a beat. They kiss deeply, passionately. Taryn moves her hand down between Jess's legs, and Jess pulls away, frowning in consternation, her eyes closed.
These are our people. Gotta save them from themselves. Even the elders who see me think the healing can't be real unless a white boy does it.
Hi, breezes in abruptly from outside.
So that's what you are now, a healer? I would have ridden the bus to the end of the line and back if I'd known you had company, sis.
How did your job hunting go today?
Mind if I use the car tomorrow? There's a file clerk thing I want to check out in the East Bay.
I told you I didn't want to use the car in the city. Waste of gas.
The temple is hiring for a lot of positions. Gift shop, food delivery, staffing the new clinic?
No, thanks.
You could at least check them out.
You bring her here to jam me about getting a job?
Look, we got bills to pay, and I can't keep bailing you out for your half every month.
I'm not asking you to. Sorry I fucked up your magic moment with the doctor here.
Thanks for the drink.
Let me walk you out.
No need. If you change your mind, Hyacinth.
How did you know that was my full name?
Wild guess. It's beautiful.
Jess exits.
Well, you two cozied up real quick.
Why the venom, Hyacinth?
She's trying to run you.
Nobody runs me.
Why is she a soldier for those white folk?
Most of the joint's black, High. Look at the neighborhoods. She's helping people with no health care, no hope, black folks with less than jack shit who got shamed that they so much as breathe about me seeing a shrink. That's why we have so much craziness around here. All the Negro pathology they want to crucify us for.
See the neighborhoods. I'm out here every damn day riding the same funky overcrowded bus, chasing the same dead ends as the 200 other no qualified women who got their noses stuck up in the air, giving me the side eye. They don't need a shrink. They need jobs that pay decent without strings attached.
Only one of those nose in the air sadities has to be hungrier than you to get a job. You let them nip at your heels, or you let the white boys get in your head.
Like you have in all these years. It's why you're out here. They got prime real estate up in there, and you're using the healer to exercise the demons.
I didn't run anywhere. Okay. And it's not as if I had to twist your arm to come. I have to get up early. Landlady said that they're checking the boiler in the morning. Hot water is going to be off after 9. You better get all your washing done tonight. You'll be here, right?
No, I won't be here. You're not the only one who's got stuff going on.
You better get all your washing done.
Scene 5, Jonestown, Guyana, Fillmore, San Francisco, 1976. The sound of labored breathing. Two men, Jemiah and Jimmy Jr., a young church member and the black son of Jim Jones, are holding shovels and pickaxes, miming digging. Woman one starts speaking.
The takeover could happen any time. It will come in a flood of parachutes, blazing military guns, contaminated water. Best to sit on the edge of preparedness than to be caught off guard, slack, flabby, complacent.
The lights go up and Sister Leslie is pacing around the men. They are dressed in dirty t-shirts and drenched in sweat. She feels their biceps and arms as they simulate the motions of digging into the ground. The men never acknowledge her.
Oh, praise be to Jesus. The rebel slaves weren't sitting waiting idly in the bushes to be slaughtered, run down like punk rabbits by the bloodhounds.
The men continue swinging their tools in unison. Sister Leslie stalks them as the women come on to join her, snapping their fingers, pacing around the men like specters, unseen and unacknowledged by the men.
All right, let's shut this down before we get caught in a real flood.
Why is nice.
Favor it, brother, once the rest of the family gets here.
Are bringing thousands, a multitude of righteous soldiers in exodus from the plague.
Limp as motherfucking jungle bugs. Nectar will start flowing from the swamp. That's what your daddy said, right?
Word is the whole Parliament of Guyana took a real shine to Reverend Father Jim. Gonna give us the keys to the kingdom. Come on now, boys, tote that barge, lift that bale.
Riff made this place their dumping ground.
Whole lot of Negroes here running around trying to speak the king's English.
That's part of the disease, little brother. Part of the disease.
Think if they speak better than the king, it'll wash the black off them.
Don't cave into the sleepwalkers, little brother. Favorite son.
Every plot, every mile, every acre, every ditch dug is for our inheritance.
Man, Jimmy, if we can make something of this place.
Paradise ain't promised.
It's when, not if, little brother.
The women come front and center, snapping their fingers in a semicircle around the men.
If not in this life, then the next. Tote that barge, lift that bell. God's eyes are smiling on us.
Fillmore, San Francisco, Jim Jones is seated in a corner. He is wearing street clothes, a casual button-down shirt, and khakis. He fondles a pair of white traditional baby shoes.
Your schooling is a dress rehearsal for everything else in life, son. It's a test, Jimmy Jr. Black boys can't afford to sleep and be mediocre niggers like the world expects. White trash, the white trash can sleep. Coast on being a quarter street smart, but you gotta be book smart, street smart, practically superhuman. Five steps ahead, fighting with your God-given mind all the time, all the time. See, I'd be up at Prophet Zeke's after church Sunday and drinking in his wisdom like the other little shits, while the other little shits were circle jerking and chasing their tails and crackers from the day they were born till the day they died. I looked into the future and saw you.
A white doctor comes on stage carrying a play telephone in a little paper cup. Jim puts out his hand and the man empties pills from the cup into it. Jim swallows them and picks up the phone. He fondles the man as he starts talking. The man reciprocates.
Leave the housing authority, Mr. Mayor? Well, I'd be right on it.
The end. Thank you, everyone. And now we'd like to introduce our cast.
Quonta Beasley as High Strayer.
Sydney Wayne Davis as the White Secretary, Jemiah and Ida Lassiter.
Cheri Miller as Ernestine and Woman One.
Aubry Kaplan as Woman Three and Sister Leslie.
Elvinette Piard as Jess, Night Watchwoman.
J.C. Cadena as the narrator.
Ella Turenne as Taryn Strayer.
Welcome our queen, our AAACC board member, Queen Maddie Scott, to the discussion tonight. And my mom is under my name, Cheri Miller. Thank you, Mom. Part of the panel, Linda Martley.
It's so great to be knowledgeable. Thank you very much, Ms. Miller.
You're very welcome, Linda Martley Jordan. Thank you for being with us.
Can I thank the students who showed up tonight?
You sure can. We do. We have students with us from the San Francisco Unified School District. Thank you so very much for being with us. Please acknowledge them, Linda Martley Jordan.
Yes, Asia. We have Asia, who is a junior. We have Jordan, who is a senior. Jada Love is a 10th grader. Jada Love is a 4.0. I just want to stress that out. We also have Lamia Hayes, who is a senior. We have Layla Polk, who is a sophomore, excuse me. We have Malaya, who is a senior. And then Miracle, who is a senior. And we have Zahara, who is also a sophomore. None of the guys could make it tonight. They did sign up, because a basketball game some kind of way became important. Okay?
Of course it did. Well, I appreciate you being with us tonight, Linda. And Linda's going to join us again on Saturday and be a part of the discussion. You're welcome to join us tonight for the discussion if you like, but if not, just sit back and enjoy the discussion. Maddie, yes, I think you're unmuted and on cam. This is my queen, y'all. Thank you for being with us tonight, Queen Maddie.
Thank you. And is that Miss Jordan, Miss Linda Jordan?
Yes, that's the infamous Linda Martley Jordan.
my sister from that I work with at Mission High School with all the young people.
Yes, ma'am. Good evening.
Oh, Ms. Jordan, I love you. You always do such great work with our young people and getting them on the right track. I just love everything about you and your wonderful daughter and all the work that you do and everything. And everybody tonight was just amazing. Just amazing, all of you. I was here feeding my mom because my mom has dementia. She's going to be 100 years old next year. And my aunt just turned 90, her sister, so I was feeding both of them. But I had to turn my computer up and have to come back rushing, feeding them, and then you wanting to make sure I didn't miss anything. And it was just truly amazing. It brought back a lot of memories for me. I lost a lot of people in Jonestown. I live in Fillmore, and that was a rough time. I was in my 20s. I'll never forget it. I lost my good girlfriend who worked at the Goodwill store on Fillmore Street. Two of my colleagues at work lost their children there. My brother who worked at, we all know, Petrini's Market, all seven of his children. So it's brought back a lot. It was very powerful. And so when is it gonna get to the stage?
Dr. Sikivu Hutchinson, the writer of the novel, the film, and the play.
Wow.
It's the Black excellence. I am privileged to be part of her cohort.
Oh, and thanks, Cheri.
Just give it over to her.
I really appreciate you. And thank you, Ms. Scott, for your reflections and lifting up and amplifying those who have perished as a result of this tragedy.
Yes.
You mentioned the multi-generational aspect of it, and that's what we really wanted to foreground. Mm-hmm. The fact that you had so many extended families that got reeled in to investing their dreams and their imaginative spirit and their energy into people's temple, investing sweat equity, investing property, funding Jonestown, the People's Temple Agricultural Settlement, to the tune of over $36,000 in Social Security benefits every month. So we really wanted to reinforce that it was Black social capital and economic capital that fueled People's Temple in Jonestown.
Oh yeah, oh yeah. And also prompted a lot of political moves, a lot of political positions, okay? Got, you know, off of the lives of those people, of our people that perished over there. A lot of people climbed the ladder, if you will, of our pain, as they always do, you know? So thank you for that.
And I think that's something that is not well known in terms of the interpretation and the representation of People's Temple in Jonestown, the mainstream, the fact that People's Temple and specifically Jim Jones were co-signed by so many Black movers and shakers, Black politicians and luminaries, folks like Merv Dimely, one-time Lieutenant Governor of California, Willie Brown, who needs no introduction, Angela Davis. That's why I want to lift up that quote from Angela Davis back in 1977, you know, right as the Jonestown settlement was on the precipice of combusting. So there's a really misguided perception that People's Temple and Jonestown were outliers, that it was a community of reprobates, when in fact, nothing could be further from the truth.
That's right. That's right. And we had a lot of clergy. Many of them are not here today with us. And I talked with them personally about that before their passing, and had a lot to do with their, you know, their health issues and what happened. So very powerful. And particularly the what you sisters brought to it, you know, the Black women bringing this is what we need to do. We need to tell our stories, because our stories haven't been told. And, you know, and to do it collectively and together, from all different backgrounds and faiths. You know, our story needs to be told. And it was, you guys did an excellent job in doing that tonight, really.
Thank you.
Thank you so much. Thank you. I wanted to just say that when we spoke with the students, Linda and I, a few days ago, they didn't know anything about this. There was no knowledge of this at all.
Mm-hmm.
So many people don't, when I've heard about it, it was said that, you know, the Black women were just, you know, led astray because they didn't know enough and they were uneducated. And that was like
farthest from the truth.
Oh my goodness. Mm-hmm. They were brilliant. They were the leaders. They wanted to, you know, they wanted to help their people, their community. Mm-hmm. And they were using everything they had to do that.
Yep. We did. That's why we're trying to definitely save the Heritage Center right there on Fillmore Street right now. We need that building. And I told them, no, we don't need to pay for it. You need to give that to us. We need to have it for free. You gave the Asian Cultural Center to the Asians for $1. You gave the library in San Francisco to them for $1. You need to give that Heritage Center to us for $1. You know, what all we have lost. That was the original Black Panther headquarters when I came here in the 60s. That's where I met Angela Davis. That's where I met Kathleen Cleaver and Eldridge Cleaver. And there was the free breakfast program there and the after school program and the first Meals on Wheels program to our seniors. All those things happened right there at that Heritage Center on Fillmore Street in Eddy, where Yoshi's used to be. And a lot of people didn't know that. They didn't know that either, you know. And so this brought that up for me too as well. You're telling the story tonight and the way you told it, you know, so much equity and empowerment that we have in our community amongst our women that never was told. But no one's going to let you forget the Holocaust, okay? Okay, so, and we should do the same with our people. Unapologetically, make sure that our young people, I make sure my grandkids know everything about Jim Crow, slavery, all of it, and who built this country. And you know, my mom and my aunt tells the story about the gown man in New Orleans that took Black people's bodies. We came up missing, thousands of Black people came up missing, particularly women, when they would take your bodies and use it for medical science back then. Because they did not have cadavers to work on. So Black women, that's why you see in the movie The Help, sisters always met at the bus stop together in a group. You always seen Black men together, and they always want to call that a gang. No, you had to be together because you couldn't be by yourself anywhere in the South because you would be kidnapped and be missing and nobody would know where you were. You wind up hung on a tree all messed up or never seen again, you know. We had lots of women in our neighborhood that lost their daughters, never came back home, never found them because of that. And that story has not been told. And we want that story told. We want that story. And Tyler Perry knows about it. We asking him to tell that story. As difficult as it is, there's not a person that did not grow up in New Orleans that do not know about that. Okay, it's not a Black person, but you never hear about it. You hear about the Holocaust, you hear about everything else, but you do not hear about what happened to us as Black people down South. And how we came up missing by the thousands and no one never said a word or said anything. And you wonder why mental health is so embedded in us, you know, and why we suffer from post-traumatic stress so much. You know, imagine your daughter not coming home or your mother not coming home from work. And you never see them again, nobody says anything. And there's nothing being done about it. And you just have to go on, you know, with your life. It's insane, it's crazy. So I'm glad we're telling these stories. There's more to come.
Yeah, and I'm really happy that you bring up that analogy between Jonestown and the Jewish Holocaust, because if we look at the numbers of those who perished in Jonestown, again, 48% African-American women, just astounding. But then when we look at the portrayals within the popular imagination and the mainstream and the fact that there is this continuous fetishization of white lives and white fragility, and white dispossession with regard to Jones and his white female lieutenants. That's something that I really wanted to amplify in this play, that there was this myth that equity existed within People's Temple when it came to decision-making and leadership and governance. And yet you had a Black face in terms of the masses, the rank and file within People's Temple and those who are in the hierarchy and actually wielding power and authority were young white folks.
Mm-hmm.
And young white women who were the beneficiaries of this regime of lording over Black bodies and appropriating, misappropriating Black property and Black sweat equity and capital. So I think that's important to bring up. And then you mentioned abduction and all of the disappearance of African-American women and girls. And we see that continuing contemporarily. When we have 34% of those who are missing and abducted in the US are African-American women and girls, yet the public face, the popular imagination and representation is yet again fixation on white women and girls.
Mm-hmm.
And I think Jonestown is an encapsulation of that disparity.
Yeah, and I'm glad you brought that up about the white female lieutenants, because it's the same scenario that was used in the divisive plan to destroy the Black Panther Party. That was Jane Fonda, one of the major white lieutenants, I call her, that they utilized back in the day. Over there in Oakland, or Emeryville, if you will, at the Watergate Hotel back then, where everybody used to go and party. Well, they threw those parties there on purpose, and they, bought the drugs, the cocaine and everything else, and, she infiltrated the Black Panther Party. We got folks, a lot of our Black men hooked on, substances. And so they always use their women to infiltrate our community as lieutenants. They did it in Jonestown and they did it with the drug culture back in the 70s to infiltrate the Black Panther Party and destroy it.
Yes. So, we have a question from Jordan. You wanna go ahead and unmute and ask? We want you to join the conversation.
Hi, everyone. My name is Jordan Nicholson Smith. I'm a rising senior at Mission. I am a senior at Mission High School. And I just wanted to say that this is exciting to hear from Black women about a piece of our history, because we don't learn about this in school, about Jonestown, and just to see the play and see that we're actually starting to bring our history out more. And today, it just makes me happy to see that. And I'm just glad to be here and see all of the writing that has been acted out, because I'm a writer myself. And it's just inspiring. Yeah.
Oh, thank you, Jordan. Much appreciated. What kind of writing do you do, Jordan? Are you a fiction writer, nonfiction, all of the above?
It's usually fiction, but I usually just write for more like assignments. But if I do have a passion, I will write about it.
That is amazing, Jordan. You got to come and visit me and let me read some of your writings. I look forward. We want you to know that the AAACC is not just, the center and the hub for events, but we're here for you. And I'd love to discuss how we can help you on your journey forward. And I think under my name is one of my executive directors. She types like my executive director. Yeah, that's, I think that's either my superhero or my mega love. And so thank you for being here with us. I think we have another question from Miracle. You wanna go ahead and unmute?
Hi, I'm Miracle Coplasure. I am a senior at Mission High School. And it really wasn't a question, but I kinda learned new history about the Jim Jones. Like, I really didn't know that much about it, but I just know on my mom's side, like, some people got affected by that too. So it was like really something new to learn about. And it's really interesting. Like, now when I get to school, I'm going to kind of research it more. But it was good to know some of my history and just to listen to my Black folks.
Thank you so much for being here with us. I've been producing the AAACC along with Linda Jordan. We've been producing the Black graduation for the last couple of years together. And so we're already starting to plan the next graduation coming up, and we're going to do it even bigger and better. and we're going to celebrate you. And so anything that we can do to help you along your journey, we are here for you. I appreciate you being with us. Linda's going to make sure that you all get more education. I'm going to work with Dr. Sikivu Hutchinson, who is an amazing writer, y'all. Way more stuff coming. I'll work with her. We'll purchase some of her books. We'll make sure that you all have it to reference. She goes in depth like nobody's business to bring forth our stories, to make sure that we know how brilliant we were, that we were not uneducated. We were not unprepared for what we had planned, but this white man preyed upon us. He murdered our brilliance. He murdered our family. He did that. They didn't do that. So thank you so very much, Miracle. Any other questions? Is there another hand raised? I think so. Okay, Malia. Hey, Malia.
Hi. Hi, I'm a mission senior. I just wanted to say thank you for taking the time out of you guys' day and organizing this event over Zoom. It's so accessible to learn more about our history and culture. It's really exciting to know that there are, you know, people trying to get more, you know, stories and words out there about the culture.
Thank you. We appreciate you. So I just wanted to make a note of definitely before we head out in terms of literature and documentation of Black women's lived experiences, that if folks want to check out Leslie Wagner Wilson's Slavery of Faith, an excellent autobiography and memoir, and one of only two written and published documentations of Black women's experiences in People's Temple in Jonestown. And there is a voluminous body of work on Jonestown and People's Temple from primarily white perspectives. And that was one of the things that motivated me to write White Nice Black Paradise.
Yeah.
Another really excellent book, nonfiction analysis, is People's Temple and Black Religion in America. And that is edited by Dr. Tony Penn, who is an African-American humanist scholar, a world-renowned African-American humanist and atheist scholar, in addition to Dr. Rebecca Moore, who is one of the curators of Alternative Considerations of Jonestown. And that, I believe, is the only publication featuring African-American writers and scholars on People's Temple in Jonestown. 40 plus years hence, that is the only one.
Yeah, I remember seeing something. Linda has a question too. And I remember seeing the movie, and it didn't make me feel good about us. You know, it lifted up this white man and this white narrative. And it just, now that I know the truth, now that I see and I've been able to research the harm that had been done to the Black community within San Francisco, the laws that were on the book, the Jim Crow laws. I mean, like, seriously, now that I have relationship with someone like Queen Maddie Scott, who's out here doing the work to help us restore our souls and our minds and our bodies and surround us with love through our grief and like the Brady gun buyback program and everything else she's doing, I'm like, we're brilliant. We're brilliant.
Yeah.
Thank you so much, Dr. Hutchinson, Sikivu.
Yes.
You know, really just taking, and I don't know how long this took you, but taking the time to really amplify our stories.
Yes.
Opportunity to Linda to ask her question really quickly. Go, Linda.
Thank you very much. I just want to say thank you, because these young people heard something tonight they didn't know. These young people were introduced to a part of our history. You're so right. I know people who were a part of the temple. They didn't do it to themselves. They had a dream. They followed along. They had a certain ideology that they felt was going to happen. And unfortunately, they flipped the switch. People lost their lives. Mm. And that was unfortunate. So what I'm loving about this is how excited these kids are. And what I'm also loving about this is the fact that it's Black women telling the story. And the more that that can happen, the better. We used to have a class at Mission High School that was the African-American Women's Heritage course, but we lost funding, so we couldn't continue teaching that. And that's unfortunate, but I do have an opportunity here and there to bring people in to speak to students and to engage with students. And now that we are we're not post-pandemic, because pandemic is still going on, but there are certain funds that we might be able to tap into so that we can put together a series of workshops for young women and young men to come in and sit down. It might happen at the African American Arts and Cultural Complex, or it might happen at a couple of our high schools. But this is what's so important, because they have to hear it from us. And I don't care what people say about CRT, critical race theory, and all that stuff. We have to engage our students in what's real and bring it to them so that they can chew on it, they can dissect it. And then they can come back with, well, wait a minute, their critical thoughts about what it is. So I appreciate you, Dr. Hutchinson, for taking the time to do this. I appreciate Cheri for making sure that the students could be a part of this. And I look forward to this relationship and partnership building out. And you know, we can get the guys here. And Maddie, you know, I love you.
Thank you so much. Thank you so much, Linda. I always, it's a privilege to partner with you all. You're the boots on the ground. I just want to acknowledge that we graduated more Black students within the last 2 years. We made record numbers, and it's because of the commitment of you all. So thank you very much, Linda, for being here with us. I also want to just really quickly shout out my executive directors, Melanie Green and Melora Green. They are under my name. They have watched. They have loved it. And did you guys want to say anything? You don't have to turn on your cam. Do you want to unmute and
say anything? Can you all hear me?
Yes.
I couldn't be more proud of this opportunity to just be in the space of so much brilliance, love, authenticity. And to be honest, it's up to us to tell our story. And it's up to us to go to those who have the lived experience so that we can empower our young people, and just to hear our young girls, our young people on this call say that they heard something new. And I can honestly hear the fire in their gut to like get underneath this. And I think that that's the torch that needs to be passed. So I just want to thank you, Dr. Hutchinson, for your courage, all the emotional labor it must have taken for you to tell this story, all that it must have taken for you to just put it out there. We're absolutely honored to be partnered with you. And, you know, we love you, Miss Maddie, our board member, our queen, our community leader. Again, you know, you lead the way, you set the pace for us, and we're just honored to be in your draft, to be real. Thank you so much. And for everyone who showed up to read, I was just captivated by each and every one of you who read, and I resonated, and I could feel the difference in each energy and spirit. And I know that each energy and spirit really felt acknowledged tonight. So just thank y'all for your courage and for showing up beautifully. I would love for us to continue doing this. Thank you, Cheri, for your leadership and pulling people together and just knowing that this is what's needed right now. So thank y'all. I'm just so honored, so proud, and so filled. Appreciate you all.
Thank you so much. I work for the best, y'all, for the best. And literally us making space, creating space, sharing space, encouraging each other on our journeys. That's what it's about. And that's what the relationship has been with me and Sikivu. That's what the relationship has been with me and Linda Marley Jordan. That's what my relationship is with my family at the AAACC. I am just so honored to have you all on this journey with me. Queen Maddie, I love you. I honor you for pressing in and joining us tonight. On Saturday, we will be joined by our next board member, Reverend Townsend, who will absolutely love this. And we will have Linda Martley Jordan on cam in the discussion. And I look forward to seeing you all again Saturday at noon. Thank you.
Thank you so much.
Our AAACC tech team, Jamil, Nassim, Don Golden, thank you so very much for holding us down tonight.
Yes.
Appreciate that. That's teamwork.
Thank you, everyone. It was an amazing
everybody.
Appreciate you all. Thank you so much. And hats off to our cast.
Yes.
Phenomenal cast of Black women.
Yes.
Honored, honored, honored.
I want to stay connected to all of you, Dr. Hutchinson, and all of you, because this work is so vitally important for us to tell our young women so they could be empowered and strengthened like we are from our parents and the things they've done, you know. And for those young people, stay encouraged and don't let writing stop you. My mom wrote her first book at 94, certainly certain. She finally wrote this book. And it's published through a Barnes & Noble called Certainly Certain, but she got it off before. Thank God she did it when she did, because she has dementia now. So,
come on, Mama.
You know, but she can still read it. She can recite these poems without even looking at them, you know. So I encourage you, you know, go after your dreams. Write the story. Let's tell our stories.
Yes. You know,
our stories are valuable. Our stories are history. Our stories are us.
Yes.
You know, and it's going to empower our future generation, because we are queens, all of us. We are queens. We are queens, okay? Like the red oak tree, like the oak trees, we stand tall and beautiful.
Oh my God.
I just love all of you. I just do. I'm so grateful that I was able to see this tonight. I was determined. Yeah.
Thank you so much.
How can we get your mom's book?
Hmm?
How can we get the book? That's your mother's.
You can get the book at Barnes & Noble. It's called Certainly Certain, Dorothy McMullen. All her grandchildren illustrated the book. All the book has been done by all of her grandchildren and great-grandchildren. Everybody's in, my whole family's in this book. So she had her book signing at Barnes & Noble a while back, and then she celebrated her birthday at Third Baptist. So we're going to have a big celebration next year. 100th birthday, and you all learned it. I'll keep you posted.
We're gonna buy the books as gifts. Don't worry.
We want everybody to come. We want Black folks to come and our young Black men and women to come. I have her friend is 101. He turned 101, Mr. Watson. And the both of them are gonna be at that party and telling these young people, this is what it looks like. This is why you shouldn't pull a gun on each other, diss each other, disrespect each other. Right here. You know what they've been through? Do you know what they've been through? What you're going through is nothing. They paved the way for you. So that's the last thing you should be doing, is calling a brother or sister out of their name or picking up a weapon to take a life.
We talked about your work with Mothers in Charge. We talked about your work with Healing for Our Nation as the founder, executive.
Yes.
We talked about your work as the executive director also at with the Brady.
Yes.
Gun reference.
Yeah, we do legislation on in the Capitol to mandate gun violence awareness and to put in legislation. So now the ghost guns, we are doing a press conference this Wednesday, next Wednesday. Mayor Breed is signing the legislation for the ghost gun ordinance, and she will be the first mayor to do that. So we're glad of that. This is going to be next. And so ghost guns are guns that you can't get ghost guns here in San Francisco. You know, but they're guns that anybody can order online. That's why the gun violence has increased, because these kids are ordering these guns online. There's no background check. There's nothing. You don't even know if your child or anyone in your house have gotten them. So be aware of it. We're telling parents to talk to your kids, talk to your young people. You know, a young man just took his life with a ghost gun. His mom didn't know he had it. He committed suicide with it. He ordered it and he committed suicide because he broke up with his girlfriend. His girlfriend broke up with him. So yeah, we definitely are doing a lot of great work on gun violence. I like to stay connected with all of you and just keep you abreast of things, because we're saving lives out here.
Yes. Yes, you are. No doubt about it. No doubt about it, Queen. I am a witness to the work that you do. I'm always happy to stand with you. And again, you make us so very, very proud. Thank you so much for joining us tonight.
Thank you. Thank you for having us.
Thank you all for being with us.
Thank you.
Sikivu, Dr. Hutchinson.
Thank you, Dr. Woo-hoo. Hutchinson.
Mm-hmm.